Here we come to the last lap, and you have a double-sided handout today. On one side you have the legend, a Decalogue, bracket S, bracket, in Leviticus 19, and on the other side of the paper, sorry for the small print, there are extracts from Leviticus chapter 25. But we'll start off with Leviticus 19. Now, if you open a Bible and look at Leviticus 19, it won't look like this. I have unscrambled those parts of Leviticus 19 that have commandments in the second person singular and those that have commandments in the second person plural. And you remember we were talking about this a couple of weeks ago, and that the fact that you could make this distinction, of course, in Hebrew and in translations of the Bible such as the Authorized Version and the Revised Version, these are made, but modern translations just use you all the time, so if you don't know Hebrew, you can't be sure which whether it's second person singular or second person plural. So I have, as it were, disaggregated them. And when you look at the two groups, the thou shalt not and the you shall and you shall not, some interesting things appear. Now, of course, this may be entirely a coincidence. But if you have a look at the bottom group, first of all, the ones with you, each of you shall fear his mother and father. You shall observe my Sabbath. You shall not turn to idols, nor make yourselves molten gods. You shall not steal. You shall not deceive. You shall not deal falsely, not swear by my name. Does that ring any bells with anybody? Does it remind you of anything? It reminds you of the Ten Commandments, doesn't it? Not in that order, but remember, honour your father and your mother. Remember to keep holy the Sabbath day. You must not make to yourself a molten image. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness, and so on. So it could well be here that we've got a version, or perhaps if or a use, a reference to the Ten Commandments here. Though, of course, as it goes on, we then have commandments that have to do with mostly religious matters. You shall not eat anything together with blood. You shall not practice soothsaying or divination. You shall not round off the corner of your heads. Now, this is not a reference to sort of getting a spoke shave and as it were, you know, sort of making your head sort of nice and smooth. It is a reference to mourning rites practiced by Israel's neighbours, and one of the ways in which asserting the separateness of the people of God is not to adopt mourning customs adopted by other peoples. So you shall make no incision in your flesh or make any writing of imprintment upon you. I don't know whether any Christian or Jewish group have seen in there something against having tattoos, which of course is a very popular thing with the young these days. But anyway, that's what it means. The implication here again is that this disfiguring of the flesh, these are said to be non-Israelite customs, and therefore the Israelites are not to observe them. Yes. Yes. Well, that's what it seems to mean. You must not make any writing of imprintment upon you.
Yeah. Also,
right. Good. Well, yes. I mean, I personally don't particularly like tattoos, though I have a very special niece who I'm taking out on Saturday week, and she has lots of tattoos. Anyway, that's up to her. You shall not turn to those with familiar spirits, nor to wizards. This, of course, again, is the commandment against what we call necromancy, consulting the dead, and so on and so forth. Right at the very bottom, it's interesting, you shall do no wrong in judgment. And then that is expanded in measurements of length, in weights or in measures of liquid. And it's interesting how into a set of religious instructions this sort of social clause comes, and at the very bottom, you shall have just scales, just stones, a just ephah, a just hin. I think I was saying last week or the week before that, of course, in ancient Israel, you don't have money in the sense of coins with a face value. You have metals, and of course you weigh them out on scales against various measuring jars and things. And Amos criticizes those who make the shekel small and the ephah large. This was sort of sharp practice you could indulge in. In other words, you could, if you were weighing out pieces of metal against some grain, you could deliberately have a weight that was a bit less than a shekel, so you didn't give so much coin, and you could have a measure that held rather more than it should do. So this is one way of selling or buying or selling that would put you at an advantage over against the person you were trading with. So what we have here then, in these U commandments, is that we have what seems to be a reference to the Ten Commandments, but expanded in certain religious directions, but also with a touch of social things. Now when we look at the top lot of commandments, the Thou ones, these are not in any way religious as they stand. In a minute I shall point out how they are then made to be religious, but they are very much social humanitarian. Thou shalt not completely harvest the corner of thy field. Remember again that a field is not what we understand by a field. I mean, when one is teaching people Hebrew, you teach them the word sadeh in Hebrew means field in English. But of course our fields, you know, areas of grass surrounded by stone in this part of the world, or fences in other parts of the world, we're not talking about that. A field is a cultivable area of land in ancient Israel, in the ancient world. Though nonetheless, you know, if you're going to sow it, it's going to have its edges. And the point is that when you harvest, you mustn't harvest it completely. Thou shalt not glean the gleaning of thy harvest. In other words, when you've picked up all the spare bits, you mustn't do it again. You mustn't glean your vineyard or the fallen grapes of your vineyard. And then really what is implicit is made explicit. I've put this in italics. Thou shalt leave them for the poor and the stranger. I am Yahweh your God. The addition of those words, and they keep coming in Leviticus 19, shows that this is not just to be thought of as a humanitarian or social provision, that life is lived in the presence of God and before God, and that God has an interest in these seemingly mundane and small things. And therefore the commandment is given a religious, a theological grounding in the faith of the people in God and their need to be loyal to him. The next one, which I think is very interesting, is when we get to thou shalt not steal, and then this is expanded again in an interesting direction. The wage of a hired worker shall not remain with thee overnight until morning. In other words, steal, yes, but what does steal mean? And steal means keeping hold of somebody's wage and not paying it until the next day. We all know that there goes on in our world today this practice of big, powerful firms delaying until the very last minute the payment of dues owed very often, you know, to small traders and that sort of thing. And you know, and sometimes it's very difficult, I think, for small traders if they're owed money by big firms that delay until the last minute to pay. And you know, one wonders whether this sort of thing, you know, ought to be made to apply. I think it's quite bad when you get that sort of thing happening. Thou shalt not curse a deaf man. Now, of course, the point about cursing a deaf man is that the deaf man isn't going to be able to hear the curse. But again, this shows a very developed, sensitive attitude, doesn't it? You know, okay, he can't hear, I'm going to curse him. But you mustn't, because God hears. You must not put an obstacle in the path of one blind. Again, because a blind person can't see it, it would be a really mean trick to do that. Why? That's his justified. Thou shalt fear thy God. I am Yahweh. Thou shalt not respect the person of the poor, nor honour the person of the great. In other words, in doing justice, you must be absolutely impartial. You mustn't be influenced by the fact that this is a poor person. You mustn't be influenced by the fact that this is a powerful person. You must be as fair as you can. Now the next one, thou shalt not stand on the blood of thy neighbour, is a very interesting one. I've given you, this is the translation of Leviticus 19, incidentally, it is my own translation of the Hebrew. And so I've given it to you literally, thou shalt not stand on the blood of thy neighbour. What does that mean? There are two main interpretations. One is that you mustn't give false evidence against someone in a capital case, which would mean, of course, if the person was convicted, they would be put to death. But there is another very interesting Jewish interpretation that reminds me of an incident that happened to me a long time ago that I'll tell you about in a moment. And that is that if you see someone in a situation of danger that might lead to their death, you've got to do something about it. And the examples are, you may see somebody drowning. You're not allowed, therefore, to stand aloof and let them drown. Or you may see them being attacked by robbers or a wild beast. Again, you're not to stand aloof. And I'm reminded when I see this verse and this interpretation of something that happened to me a very long time ago when I was studying in Jerusalem. And during one of the holidays, I went up to the northern part of the land and was staying on Mount Carmel, which is not a hill, but it's a range of mountains. And as I used to do a lot, I went for a very long walk on my own. And I was going along and I was passed by a car, and about 100 yards ahead of me, this car was suddenly set upon by two very large, fierce-looking dogs that ran in front of it, slowed it down, and of course as it tried to get away, they were around barking. Well, I was a bit worried by this, as you can imagine, and thought at that point it would be nice, wouldn't it, if the people in this car who'd seen me, they just passed me, you know, seeing these dogs, you know, were to think, well, what's going to happen when he gets up to there, you know, on his own? Anyway, they didn't. Off they went. Fortunately, I saw a good piece of wood lying by the side of the road that, you know, was a very good stick, and I picked it up. And as I approached the dogs, I waved it menacingly in their direction. And, well, to my relief, they stayed on the edge of the estate that they were guarding. But I always think of that incident when I see this verse and this interpretation of it. Thou shalt not stand on the blood of thy brother. Then, just to go down a little bit further, thou shalt not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love to thy neighbour like thyself. This, of course, is the famous second commandment, which we are familiar with in the New Testament and in normal translations as thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. And people are often surprised to discover that the second of the great commandments, thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself, actually comes from Leviticus of all places. But I've given it a literal translation here because I wonder if you ever ask yourself, what does it mean, thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself? I mean, does it mean you've got to love your neighbour in the same way that you love yourself? But in what way do you love yourself? Is it a good thing to love yourself? Is this enlightened self-interest or what? The interesting thing about the Hebrew here is that normally the verb to love in Hebrew takes the direct object. In Hebrew there's a little word et, which you don't translate, but we call it the object marker. And you stick that in front of a definite word if it is the object of a verb. But here, as I've translated it, there is an indirect object. Thou shalt love to thy neighbour. Thou shalt love to thy neighbour, like thyself. And the meaning, therefore, is probably in the context here, whatever people make of it in the New Testament, where it's in Greek, of course, and quoted in the New Testament in Greek, but you must show respect to your neighbour, because like yourself, he is a human being. You must give respect to your neighbour, because like you, he or she is a human being, which I think therefore makes much better sense. But one of the troubles is, you know, we hear these phrases, don't we, and we're not encouraged to think about them. Thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. Now, what does it mean? Well, there's one meaning. You must show respect to your neighbour, for like you, he or she is a human being. The next one, thou shalt not make thy cattle lie down in two kinds. This is a prohibition against making animals sort of mate with animals that are not their own sort, and you know, which of course obviously could be very dangerous to some of them. Thou shalt not sow thy seed in two kinds. I don't know why this is forbidden. Again, one suggestion is that this was something that Israel's neighbours did, and this was one way of avoiding it. And you get other instructions in the Old Testament that you mustn't make your coat with two different types of cloth. You mustn't mix silk and linen and so on. Again, I don't know much about that. Thou shalt not profane thy daughter. Remember that in ancient Israel, the father had the power over his family and could, if necessary, sell daughters into slavery. The last but one, I think, is very good. Thou shalt rise up in the presence of grey hair. I'm sure I'm not the only one, although I've got rid of most of my grey hair, but you know, it's certainly there. I think a lot of us would think that's a very appropriate. But you must honour the presence of the elders. Yes, I think again that's a very good very good instruction. Now, what we've got in Leviticus 19, I think, is that we've got the working together of several different traditions, and this is something that we've seen in the study of collections of laws. They bring together different things, and I think that we've got a version of the Ten Commandments that has been expanded with some other religious observances, although at the bottom there you see how there has crept in this clause about having just weights and measures. Then we've got another collection in the second person singular of almost entirely humanitarian provisions. And these have been woven together in the context of Leviticus 19. And if you want to see how they have been woven together, then you'll need to read the authorized version or the revised version, a version that tells you which are thou shalt and which are you shall. And as they've been put together, the reason for these commandments is put in the context of God. You must fear God, I am Yahweh, I am the Lord your God. Because these rules are not just humanitarian, they're not just religious things, they are grounded in Israel's conviction that its behaviour should be a reflection of what God wants the society, should be, as it were, a God-shaped society, which includes, therefore, not only religious things, but secular things. And I like to think that what we've got going on in Leviticus chapter 19 is, if you like, a new definition of holiness. A definition of holiness, just not just simply in religious terms, but a definition of holiness that embraces the social and goes to the point of, you know, not cursing the deaf when they can't hear, and not putting an obstacle in the way of the blind, and also the compassion to animals that comes in, and the compassion to the land. Okay, let's turn over now. I'm sorry for the small print on the other side of the page. And as it is, I've left out a few verses. This is about the Sabbath year and the Jubilee. And the question that people ask is, you know, were these laws ever observed? Now, remember what I said 3 weeks ago when we were looking at the laws of Hammurabi, that the laws of Hammurabi, as far as we know, were never appealed to as statute law. You remember that quotation, and I read it again last week. You know, in all the thousands of instances that we've got of cases, nobody ever refers to the laws of Hammurabi and says we've got to do this because it says in Hammurabi. And the laws of Hammurabi are illustrative rather than things that were appealed to and enforced. And we've got to bear that in mind when we're looking at these laws, especially the Jubilee laws, because we have to ask the question, if every 50th year these things are going to happen, I mean, who sort of keeps a reckoning of this? I mean, you know, 50 years is going to occur once in our lifetime, if we can remember it. I mean, some of us may live to over 100. I mean, we're not going to be much over 100, and we're probably not going to remember, you know, sort of two lots of 50 years. I mean, who's going to enforce this? And so what we may have here is more an ideal than something that was actually enforced. But that doesn't matter. Whether it was actually enforced, that doesn't matter. It is what it is saying. It's the spirit of what it's about that is important, not the letter. It starts off, however, with the Sabbaths. So, the Lord spake unto Moses, this is the authorized version here, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when ye come into the land which I give you, then shall the land keep a Sabbath unto the Lord. 6 years thou shalt sow thy field, and 6 years thou shalt prune thy vineyard, and gather in the fruit thereof. But in the seventh year shall be a Sabbath of rest unto the land, a Sabbath for the Lord. Thou shalt neither sow thy field nor prune thy vineyard. Okay. Now, that, of course, is something that could have operated, if it ever did operate, locally. In other words, if you lived in Bethlehem and had a field there and you wanted to knew about this and wanted to apply it, you'd say, okay, this is my field, I'm going to, you know, sow it for 6 years, and the seventh year I will let it lie fallow. And somebody living in Samaria could be doing the same thing, but not at the same time, okay? But when it comes to the Jubilee, this is a different matter altogether, as we shall see. So verse 8, thou shalt number 7 Sabbaths of years unto thee, 7 times 7 years, and the space of the 7 Sabbaths of years shall be unto thee 49 years. Thou shalt cause the trumpet of the Jubilee, that's how it's spelt in the authorized version, with only one E, to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month. In the Day of Atonement shall ye make the trumpet sound throughout the land, and ye shall hallow the 50th year, and proclaim liberty throughout all the land and to all the inhabitants thereof. It shall be a jubilee unto you, and ye shall return every man unto his possession, and she shall return every man unto his family. Now, as I say, that could only make sense if somebody, you know, this couldn't be done locally. This can't be done locally. It surely got to be done nationally, and therefore it's got to suppose an authority that can regulate this, can count the years, decide when the Jubilee comes along, and when all these things are going to obtain. And, you know, and that very fact makes you wonder whether this is intended to be enforced or whether it could be. We know that sabbatical years were later on observed, because we've got some information in Josephus and the first book of Maccabees that in later times of Herod, there were Sabbath years. This, of course, if it was ever enforced, would bring enormous hardship, because year 49 and year 50 would both be years where you weren't to do any agriculture. I mean, 2 years running, you'd have to sort of rely on, what was stored up. Okay, so you've got this Jubilee. But now we get the laws connected with the Jubilee, and these are important things, and really there are two important things happening here. the first thing that is happening is that the sale of land is being abolished. And I'll explain that in a minute. The sale of land is being abolished. And later on, slavery is being abolished. Now, last week, when we were looking at Deuteronomy 15, we saw that how Deuteronomy 15 is an advance, apparently, on what we get in Exodus 21, because in Exodus 21, if a man sells himself into slavery and becomes a slave together with his wife and family, the man is freed after 7 years, but not his wife. In Deuteronomy, there's a definite addition of the woman, so that the woman has the same right as her husband in Deuteronomy. Here, in Leviticus, we'll come on to that in a minute, slavery is abolished altogether. And let me remind you, as I said last week, that when we talk about slavery, we are not talking about the sort of slavery that went on in the Greco-Roman world. We're not talking about the slavery that went on in the 17th, 18th centuries, you know, when people sailed to parts of Africa, rounded up black people on the point of a gun, shipped them across the Atlantic to the West Indies. We're not talking about slavery in that sense at all. And of course, it's rather odd that when there were moves to abolish slavery, people actually appealed to the Bible in support of the institution of slavery, not realizing that slavery in the Bible is quite different. And slavery only comes about when people have to sell themselves in slavery. In other words, become voluntary slaves because their debts have become so great that they can't pay their debts. And the only way that they can settle their debts is by giving up their freedom. But they do that, okay, because of pressures, but not because somebody else comes along with a gun and so on to force them into a totally different way of life. So, first of all, how is the sale of property abolished? It's abolished in this way. The distinction, perhaps, that we would call the distinction between freehold and leasehold. Now, if you own the freehold of your land, and in Sheffield not many people do, and I think where I live in Broomhill, most of the land there is leasehold on a lease of 800 years from the middle of the 19th century, which I think say should be long enough for most of us. So if the land is leasehold, of course, when the lease runs out, you lose it. If it's freehold, it's yours forever. But remember, some years ago, an Act of Parliament was passed to enable people to buy their freehold. You remember, if they were leaseholders, they could buy their freehold. And of course, and the cost, what they had to pay, would depend on how long the lease had got to run. And so, obviously, there'd be some adjustment. And this is precisely what is going on in the laws that follow in a minute. That the Jubilee sets, as it were, a marker. And if you have had to sell your land, and then you want to buy it back, or one of your kinsmen wants to buy it back, you've not sold your land. You have sold what we would call that land is leasehold. What the person who's bought your land has bought is the right to work that land, to grow crops, and to benefit from the crops and so on that are bought. But the person doesn't become the outright owner. And so if the person whose land it is wants to buy back the land, as it were, we would say perhaps by end the lease, the amount of the lease is going to be calculated according to how many years are left of the Jubilee. Are you with me? And let me then read out the verses, because they don't make any sense unless you realize that they're not talking about selling the land, they're talking about selling to the buyer the use of the land. And when the Jubilee comes, that use of the land comes to an end. So, this is verse 14, if you could pick up the tiny figures. If thou sell aught unto thy neighbour, or buyest aught of thy neighbour's hand, ye shall not oppress one another. According to the number of years after the Jubilee, thou shalt buy of thy neighbour, and according to the number of the years of the fruits he shall sell unto thee. So when you're calculating the original price, it's going to be in relation to how many years are left of the Jubilee. And obviously if there aren't many years of the Jubilee left, that's going to be one price. And if there are lots of years left of the Jubilee, now that's going to be another price. According to the multitude of years, thou shalt increase the price thereof, and according to the fewness of years, thou shalt diminish the price of it. For according to the number of years of the fruits doth he sell unto thee. The land shall not be sold for ever, for the land is mine, for ye are strangers and sojourners with me. And in the land of your possession ye shall grant a redemption of the land. So this is the first thing, therefore, that the sale of land is prohibited. Now, a lot of the commentators and experts try to argue that this is a very ancient provision in ancient Israel, that very early on it was believed that God owned the land, or it was the tribe or whatever it is that owned the land. I have argued recently in several publications that in fact this is a very late development, and it seems to be lots of evidence in the Old Testament that powerful land owners and landholders could actually accumulate their land, particularly if you've got bad harvests, and if you were a big powerful man and you had grain storage and so on and so forth, you could drive a hard bargain. Think of what Joseph does in the story of Joseph in Genesis. You remember there's the 7 good years and the 7 lean years, and Joseph causes all these storehouses to be built, and he stores up the land, and when the 7 bad years come along and people haven't got any grain, he can sell this, and I think he more or less sort of takes over the land, just as Joseph in the story. So that sort of thing can happen. And you get those people condemned in Isaiah chapter 5. Woe unto you who join house to house and field to field. And I think, therefore, that what we've got as we come down to the period when this was written, 4th, 3rd century BC, I suppose, the conviction has grown that it is precisely property and land owning that brings about social distortions and brings about the acquisition of power and wealth by some, which they use to exploit others. And of course we see this in today's world, don't we, when you think of the fact that wealth, land, power is in the hands of a tiny minority of people. I don't know what it is. Is it sort of 10% of the population? They own about 80 or 90%. And you can see how this whole business of acquiring of property is the acquiring of power. And what Leviticus is doing is saying that should not be so. And the Jubilee, therefore, is a method of preventing the accumulation of property and therefore power by one class in order then to exploit the other class. So the first thing the Jubilee does is it is a way of making sure that land cannot be sold. All that is sold is the right to use the land. And when the Jubilee comes along, that right ceases to exist, and the land has to be given back to the original owner. The other thing that is done is that slavery is abolished entirely here. If we look down to verse 39, again, if you could see the, I apologize for the tiny numbers. If thy brother that dwelleth with thee be waxen poor and sold unto thee, thou shalt not compel him to serve as a bond servant, but as an hired servant, and as a sojourner he shall be with thee, and shall serve thee unto the year of Jubilee. Then shall he depart from thee, both he and his children with him, and shall return to his own family, and unto the possession of his fathers shall he return. And of course, this again is clear. So why has this person become a slave? Because perhaps of poor harvests, the need to borrow, need to come into debt. And if that happens, nonetheless, the person may not become a bond servant. He becomes a hired servant, a day laborer. He retains his freedom. And, of course, when the Jubilee comes, not only is he set free, but his land becomes his, and any indebtedness is then wiped out. I mean, this is the extent to which the Jubilee campaign perhaps had some justification in basing itself on Leviticus 25, although Leviticus 25 doesn't directly say anything about the cancellation of debts. It's, as we saw last week, it's Deuteronomy 15 that does that. So, what we've got then in this remarkable chapter are two things. The abolition of the acquisition of property and the abolition of slavery. And the reason given again is a religious reason. You were strangers in the land of Egypt. In fact, the Israelites were in slavery in Egypt. And they were delivered from there. And God did not deliver his people from slavery so that they could enslave each other, so that some could acquire power that could be used to oppress others. This is therefore religiously grounded, humanitarian, what I call structures of grace. The desire to create a society which not only reflects the graciousness of God, but reflects the graciousness of people to each other, that enables people to live a dignified life. Indeed, one might sum it all up in that verse that we came across in Leviticus 19. You must have respect for your neighbor, because like you, he or she is a human being, but a human being redeemed and known and treasured by God.